Hello everyone, I am Tanvi Kaur and I welcome you to this series called RBI 247. In this very series, we pick up some important financial topics and we try to discuss them with the help of different questions. So before beginning up with the session, for all those who are watching this video for the very first time, you can subscribe to our channel and press this bell icon for all latest updates and notifications. You can also join our Telegram group where we share some free quizzes, the updates for all our videos, and you can also post your queries over here. Before moving on to question number one, there is a piece of information which I would like to share with you all. So we have come up with 2022 RBI Grade B course for you all. So this is the course which we have launched, which will help you prepare for both phase 1 as well as phase 2. So this is the complete package which is being offered at a 30% discount. Now let me tell you a bit about what we are going to provide you in this very course. So as I said, it will help you prepare for both your phase 1 as well as phase 2. As part of phase 1, we'll be providing you all the PDFs and the videos which will help you prepare for reasoning, logical, verbal. We will also provide you sessions on GA, static GK, committees. Then along with that, all the ESI related current affairs will be covered through the government, schemes as well as the PIB analysis. Along with this, you will be provided the mocks for both your phase 1 as well as phase 2 preparation. Talking about phase 2, again we'll be providing the videos as well as PDFs to help you prepare for finance, management, ESI, all the current affairs related to that will also be covered. Along with that, we are going to provide you mocks for all the three areas, that is finance and management, ESI, as well as English descriptive. So 10 mocks each will be provided for all of these three. And these mocks have been framed keeping in mind both the objective as well as the descriptive part. So both of those things will be included in these mocks. Along with this, another thing which has been added this time is the books. So we are going to provide you with some books along with a part of this. So basically with this course, you'll be getting the access to some books like the question bank for phase 1, the question bank for phase 2. Along with that, you'll also get the past year papers for this very exam. And we have also prepared a book for you where you'll be provided with the summary sheets which will help you revise your revise the things related to your RBI Grade B exams. Along with that, we are also planning to come up with an essay book which can again help you prepare better for this exam. For further details, you can visit our website and check out the details. Now let's move ahead and begin our session. So this is the very first question which says, what does it refer to over here? So as you can see, two statements are mentioned and we have to identify what is being talked about over here. So the first statement says, it is the act. What is it? It is the act that allows banks and financial institutions to recover their dues from borrowers without the intervention of court. So it's very important that while reading the question, you underline some keywords or you keep those keywords in mind, which will help you answer the question in a better manner. So this is the act which will help the borrower, which will help in recovery of the money from the borrower without court's intervention. The second statement says, it is the legislation that helps address the problem of NPAs through different processes and mechanisms. So what is being talked about here? First of all, NPAs. I've already taken a detailed session on the non-performing assets. The loans of the banks which are not recovered in due time and are basically classified as non-performing. Why non-performing? Because it was expected that that amount along with interest will be returned in a stipulated time period, but it is not returned. So it turns out to be non-performing for the banks. So when there are NPAs, there's obviously a need to recover the amount. So different steps have been taken, be it setting up of the debt recovery tribunals, be it the IBC code. So one of the acts is being asked in this very question, which is basically an initiative to recover those NPAs. So what is that act? The act referred to over here is SARFAESI Act. How can we recognize that? They are talking about an act which will help in recovery without the court's intervention. Before SERFICI Act, we had debt recovery tribunals in place which were going to help us recover the amounts without the need to go through the court. But the recovery process was not that very good and some improvements were needed. Moreover, there were still various decisions which were going on to the courts, and the decisions basically were given by the court. So a lot of time got wasted in that very thing. So there was a need to come up with some reform, and this act came up. Under SERFICI Act, you can go for asset reconstruction, for recovery of loans without the involvement of banks. So what is this asset reconstruction? What recovery process is available under SERFICI? I'll be discussing it up in this very session. So SERFICI Act was passed in the year 2002, which was an act to help banks recover their dues without court's intervention. So it was going to help in resolving this problem of NPAs. What does SERFICI stands for? It stands for Securitization and Reconstruction of Financial Assets and Enforcement of Security Interest. Now you might think that why is the name so confusing? It's not confusing. It's focusing on three key words which are actually the means which are available to recover the amount under this very act. So securitization, reconstruction of assets, and the enforcement of security interests. These three are the key words. I'll discuss up this in the session further, and then you can easily remember the name of this act or the full form of this act. So the answer to this question is option C. Now let's move ahead to our next question. In this very question, the SERFICI Act will be more clearer to you. So let's have a look at the question. It says, which of the following statements correctly states the objectives of SERFICI Act? Now, before going through these statements, let us just discuss the objectives of this act. As I've already told you, this act was passed to help in recovery of the loans which have turned out to be NPAs without court's intervention. So one of its objectives is to recover your NPAs. So whatever loans have turned into NPAs, you need to ensure the recovery of that. Secondly, it focuses on recovery without court's intervention. So how can we recover the things without court intervention? Because a lot of time gets wasted in it. Now, talking about the further objectives, the next objective is to provide a legal framework for the securitization. Now, what is securitization? It is basically converting the loans into securities. So you can club up those loans, convert them into securities, sell those securities, and raise some funding. This is one of the means which is available to recover the amount. Then we have, so this act is going to provide us the framework within which we can basically securitize our assets. Then we have enforcing the security interests without court intervention. So you can recover the amount without court intervention. You can also enforce the security interest. So what is this is enforcing security interest? For example, if you have given a loan, if you as a bank have given a loan and you are not able to recover it, so being a lender, you have the right to give a notice to your borrower that please pay the amount within 60 days. If despite of that, the person is not able to repay, then you can enforce your security interest. That is, you can enforce your right. You will take over that property. You will have the title, the right over that property. And you can further maybe sell that property, manage that property to recover your amount. All this is allowed without the need to intervene courts in between. So you can enforce your security interest without the court's intervention. Other than that, you can auction the property, you can sell the property, again without the court's intervention. So you can auction, you can sell and recover that your amount. Once you have given a notice, the person doesn't repay, then you are given this right under this very act. So these are few objectives of this act. Now let's read the statements one by one. So the first one says it ensures efficient recovery of non-performing assets of financial institutions and banks. Obviously, it is helping in the recovery for the banks, for different kinds of financial institutions. So this statement is absolutely correct. It is one of the objectives of this act. Second one says it helps in time-bound recovery of money. This statement might seem correct, but it is not. The keyword here is time-bound recovery. Now, I have already taken one of the sessions on the insolvency and bankruptcy code. If you remember, I told you that this was the bankruptcy law which came up to ensure the time-bound recovery. Before that, the recovery of NPAs was taking place, but the time taken to recover was humongous. So there was a need to come up with some reform, and thus IBC code came, which focused on the time-bound recovery. So time-bound recovery was not there before IBC. Then we have the third statement, which says it helps to transfer the NPAs to asset reconstruction companies for the reconstruction of assets. This statement is correct. This is also one of the objectives, that is, you can recover NPAs by passing on your NPAs to the asset reconstruction companies, who will then restructure them, sell them, or maybe manage them to ensure their recovery. So this statement is again correct. Then we have the fourth one, which says it allows banks and financial institutions to auction the properties when buyer is unable to repay the loan. So this statement again states that the banks and financial institutions can auction the property. So this was one of the objectives which I discussed up with you. So this statement is again correct. Now, if we look at the options, they say we had to identify the correct one. So the first, third, and the fourth one is correct, and second is incorrect. So answer is option D. Let's move ahead to question number 3. With this, till this, we have discussed what was SURF IC Act, when did it come up, and what were some of its objectives. So let's see what's there in this third question. This is the objectives which I discussed up with you. So the third question says, which of the following statements is or are incorrect about different provisions of SURF IC Act? So let me discuss up with you all the recovery process of NPAs under this act, what provisions are applicable, and then we'll read these statements. So if I talk about the loans which have turned out to be non-performing, only the secured loans are covered under this act. So if there are secured loans, that is, they are supported by collateral, and the loan amount is more than 1 lakh, then you can recover that amount under this very act. Further, what is the recovery process available? You can go either for securitization, for asset reconstruction, and take up the enforcement of, or basically undergo the enforcement of security interests. So let me discuss these three things with you once again. I already covered securitization, which means converting your loans into securities and then selling those securities to the institutional buyers, to the banks, to the institutions, and recovering some amount. So loans are converted into securities, which are further sold, and the amount can be recovered. So this is securitization, that is converting into securities. So you convert the assets or the loans into securities. Talking about next is asset reconstruction. So we need to reconstruct the assets. The assets have turned out to be non-performing. We need to reconstruct them and turn them into the performing assets. So what we have to do, we have to convert our non-performing assets into performing assets. What happens in this case, the banks will hand over their loans which are not being recovered to the asset reconstruction companies which are there. Those companies will then undergo different things to recover that amount. So what can the asset reconstruction companies do to recover the amount? They can obviously take over the management of that firm. So they can manage that firm better and make it run in a proper manner, thereby earning profits and help to recover your loans. Secondly, you can sell or lease the business. So you can sell that borrower's business if he is not repaying you, because you have taken the collateral. So you can sell it off and you can recover your amount. Then what other options are available? You can also reschedule the payments. So say you can change the time period within which they can repay you. You can change the interest amount which they have to repay, because you are focusing on recovering as much amount as possible. So these are few options which are available. You can even enter into a settlement of some amount that, okay, you pay this much, then we'll settle the loan. So these are some options which are available. Next is the next which we have is enforcement of security interests. I already discussed this, that you can take over the right over that property, the title of that property, and then you can maybe sell it off, lease it off, manage it, okay, and thus recover your amount. So this was the recovery procedure which can be followed. One can take the possession, sell that property, manage it, and somehow try to recover as much amount as possible. So now let's move back to our question. I hope this concept is clear to you. So the statement one says, the law does not apply to unsecured loans and loans up to 3 lakh. So obviously it does not apply to unsecured loans. It applies to only secured loans. But does it? So the law does not apply to loans up to 3 lakhs. ये जो लॉ है इसके लिए आपका लोन अमाउंट शुड बी मोर देन 1 lakh, राइट? द सेकंड स्टेटमेंट सेज द लॉ अलाउज द क्रिएशन ऑफ असेट रिकंस्ट्रक्शन कंपनीज एंड अलाउज द बैंक्स टू सेल देयर एनपीएस टू असेट रिकंस्ट्रक्शन कंपनीज. सो दिस इज अगेन करेक्ट. द थर्ड वन सेज सिक्योरिटाइजेशन, असेट रिकंस्ट्रक्शन एंड इन्फोर्सिंग द सिक्योरिटी इंटरेस्ट्स आर द मेथड्स ऑफ रिकवरी. आई डिस्कस दीज थ्री रिकवरी मेथड्स विद यू ऑल. सो दिस स्टेटमेंट इज करेक्ट. एज आई हैव टोल्ड यू, दिस लॉ अप्लाइज टू ओनली द सिक्योर्ड लोन्स एंड लोन्स बियॉन्ड 1 lakh. सो हियर इट शुड हैव बीन beyond 1 lakh it is applicable, below 1 lakh not applicable. So this statement is incorrect, right? We had to identify the incorrect only one. Now let's move on to question number 4. Before that, okay, let us read this question. It says, which of the following statement correctly states the recent amendments of SERFICI Act? So this act came up in the year 2002. After that, various amendments came up. So let's read these statements and side by side, I'll be discussing what was the amendment. So first statement says, government amended the SERFICI Act in 2015 to empower the asset reconstruction companies, rejuvenate the debt recovery tribunals, and to enhance the effectiveness of asset reconstruction under the new bankruptcy law. So the key word here is new bankruptcy law. When did the new bankruptcy law came up? The new bankruptcy law which came up was IBC, which came up in the year 2016. In order to support this law, there was a dire need to improve on our asset reconstruction companies, to empower them more, to empower the debt recovery tribunals so that IBC code could properly be implemented. So that is when this act was amended. In 2016, SERFICI Act was amended and various changes were brought in. So some of the changes included the empowerment of your asset reconstruction companies, debt recovery tribunals, making the processes more online. Then they also came up with more clear-cut definitions of various terms. So these were few changes which are suggested in 2016. So this statement is incorrect. Talking about the second statement, it says the recovery procedure under SFIC Act is not applicable to cooperative banks. So there was a lot of hue and cry related to including the cooperative banks under your recovery process of SFIC. So what happened in 2002, this act came up. Okay, there was no clear cut saying that cooperative banks are included. It just said that banks are going to be included. So then in year 2003, they came up with a notification that cooperative banks will be included. There were a lot of petitions filed against this. On what ground? On the ground that already this cooperative bank is covered under the Cooperative Societies Act. So why should it get the relief both under the Cooperative Societies Act as well as SFIC Act? But then what happened in 2013? Amendment came up under which the cooperative banks were included under this act. But then further more petitions came up. Finally, in the year 2020, in the month of May last year, the Supreme Court gave a verdict that cooperative banks will be included in the recovery process of which is available under the SFIC Act. They say that it also means a bank as per the Banking Regulation Act, and it's not that they are basically clashing the rules related to Cooperative Societies Act or SFIC Act. So they should be given the relief under SFIC Act as well. So that is when the SFIC Act was invoked to the cooperative bank. So this statement is incorrect. The third one says that the recovery procedure under SFIC Act is applicable to the cooperative banks. So this statement is correct. Now reading the next statement, it says the union budget of 2021-22 proposed to increase the threshold for NBFCs from 30 lakhs to 50 lakhs to initiate the recovery proceedings. Similarly, we have next option as well, which says that the union budget increased the threshold from 20 to 50 lakhs. So now let's identify, is there any statement out of these which is correct? Talking about NBFCs, it was recently in news that NBFCs have been given some relaxation in the recovery proceedings. Now the amount, as I've already told you, for banks was more than 1 lakh. For NBFCs, there were certain limits which were specified. NBFCs which can recover the amount under this very act should have a minimum asset size of 100 crores. If they are having this size, then they will be treated as a financial institution. Now, in order to recover the debts, their debts should be of amount exceeding 50 lakhs. So this was the limit which was specified for NBFCs. But as you all know, this year or last year was a period of COVID. So because of that, there were a lot of loans which were not being recovered. So NBFCs also demanded for some relaxation. And finally, this year's budget gave them that relaxation, and it has been proposed to reduce the threshold limit. Earlier, the threshold limit was 50 lakh for these NBFCs. So loans which were beyond 50 lakhs could be recovered under the SFIC Act, but this amount has been reduced this very time to 20 lakhs. So 20 lakhs se zyada ke agar aapke loans hain, then you can recover that under SFIC Act, and this is for your NBFCs. So both of these statements say that the threshold limit was increased. No, it was not increased. It was actually decreased. So if we have a look at the options, only C option was correct. The question was asking us about the correct statement. So answer is option C. This was all for today's session. So let us just brush up what we did today. We basically tried to understand the SFIC Act, when it came up, why it came up, what were its objectives, what was the recovery process under this very act, why it was named so, and then we discussed some of the amendments, some of the major amendments which came up recently in 2016-2020. So this was all for today's session. I hope you found this session to be useful. With this, I would like to end up this session. Thank you so much.